Today is January 16th, 1996. The survivor who is going to be interviewed is Kurt Moses. His name at birth was Kurt Moses. The interviewer is Dr. Pat Sarapadva. The interview is occurring in Pompano Beach, Florida, USA, and the interview will be in English. This is tape one of an interview on January 16th, 1996. With Mr. Kurt Moses. We are doing the interview in Pompano Beach, Florida. And would you like to tell us your name and spell it and your name at birth and your age and your birth date and your city and country of birth and spell those if you would?
Sure. My name is Kurt, spelled K-U-R-T, Moses, M-O-S-E-S. I was born July 18, 1925. In Linnick, Germany. Linnick is spelled L-I-N-N-I-C-H.
Your age and birthday?
My age is 70. I was born July 18, 1925.
Mr. Moses, what was life like for you before the war?
Well, I would say where we lived in this little town in Linnick, population approximately 2,000, was like any other little town where a child grew up. It was not much excitement and a very normal life. My family consisting of my parents and my older sister. And we lived, looking back, in very good circumstances. My father had a business, like a department store, which he had inherited from his parents, who died in Linnick. They're buried in Linnick in a cemetery. And comparatively, I would say we were in the upper middle class. We had a chauffeur, we had a Mercedes-Benz then, we had a sleeping maid, and we had employees working for us, and we used to go on regular vacations, and I would say, looking back, life was very easy, very good over there. We had relatives that lived close by, and my dad was active in the community. He was a veteran of the First World War. He had been 2 years in active duty when the war started, so actually he was 6 years in the military, of which he was very proud, and he had what they called the Iron Cross, which was quite an accomplishment then. And I would say we were very happy people there. I've been there for so many generations. Until, of course, the change came when Hitler became the Reich Chancellor when he was elected.
What year was that?
I believe it was 1933. And I remember my dad had a friend who went to one of his campaign speeches, to Hitler's campaign speeches. And I remember when he came back, he told my mother, he said, you know, my friend told me this man is very dangerous. He said when he stood there and listened to him, screaming and yelling, and he said this lady that stood next to him said to him, look at this man, doesn't he remind you of God? And life started to change rapidly after he became the head of the country. In Linnick itself, we had, Jewish life was great. We had no problems. We had friends. My friends were non-Jewish children. My parents socialized with non-Jewish friends. The word Jew never was question. The only difference was on Sundays they went to their church, and on Saturdays we went to our temple. We had a great community life there. We had a rabbi who was also the teacher. We had our own school. And there were only about 15, 18 Jewish families in the whole town. The remarkable thing was they all had a business. Looking back, I don't think anybody had a job. Everybody had a little business somehow, whether it was the tailor or the shoemaker. And it, I would say all in all was a good life. We had a kosher butcher store. And our rabbi's name was Max Gottlieb. He was a man also in the community, very well respected. Like I said, until gradually the change came. And sure enough, we noticed people who became members of the Nazi party, and they formed their groups. And I remember when they first started marching and singing songs, anti-Semitic songs. And I remember when they passed our house in groups and marched, and they used to sing these anti-Semitic songs. I remember one very well. It said, when the Jewish blood spatters from our knives, that's when life will get better. And I remember my parents standing behind the curtains and watching who the people were. And every time it happened, they said, I can't believe that this one is also a member now, and I can't believe that this person joined the party, and so forth. And they must have become very depressed to see people that they had grew up with and associated with all of a sudden making such a turn. And then, of course, the boycotting started. They erected signs that they shouldn't patronize and buy at Jewish establishments and so forth, and it started to affect our business. I remember they posted a Nazi photographer in front of our business, and his job was to take pictures to keep a record of who the people were that still were buying in Jewish stores. So all in all, with the whole package, my dad felt that it wasn't too good, and he couldn't see any way that it would get better for the time being, and he decided to move across the border, which we lived very close to the Dutch border. Linnik is very close, just a few miles, and he did have business connections with people in Holland, so it wasn't a big thing for us to just move the business over to the Dutch side. And this is what we did. And I remember in the Jewish community, it was quite an upset because we were the first ones. Nobody ever heard of anybody leaving this town. And they kind of were upset. And I asked them, what are you afraid of? Are you chicken? Just because this man is there, you want to run away from it? You know, after all, you have an obligation to be here and so forth. But he decided to move, and we did move to the Dutch side.
What year was that?
1933.
Were you still going to school in Germany before you moved?
Yeah, we had this Jewish school there. We had our own school. And well, actually, only, you know, I was about 7 or 8 years old, so I maybe went 1 hour. Maybe close to 2 years that I went to school there. But I still remember the German language. This teacher we had there was very professional, and whatever he taught me, I still remember. And then, of course, in Holland, everything was Dutch. That's really where I grew up. And I spent most of my time in Holland, so to speak.
What city did you move to in Holland?
We moved first to a little town called Geleen, which is also across the border, and later to Sittard.
Could you spell that for us?
Sittard, S-I-T-T-A-R-D.
Mm-hmm.
And Sittard is a border town. It's half a mile from the, you can walk. We used to walk from Holland into Germany. So it's people in that area, there weren't any great limitations, used to cross the border as they wanted to. And Holland, life was beautiful before the war. We had a furniture factory in Holland, and which was very successful, and we had a great life there. And of course, everybody was hoping that the end of the Nazis wouldn't be too far away, and then things would go back to normal. Of course, as we know, that wasn't the case. But we lived very peacefully, and we really, I would say if things would have stayed normal, I don't think we would have gone back to Germany, because life in Holland was really good and the people were great.
Who were your friends?
And a lot of friends in Holland. I still have.
Were they Jewish and non-Jewish?
Non-Jewish. Mm-hmm. We did have a temple in Sittard too, and we had a rabbi. His name was Van Blydenstein. He was a very gifted man, great violinist besides. And life continued where we left off, so to speak of. And it was just beautiful. And then, of course, on May 10, 1940, the German invasion happened. And, of course, since we were 5 minutes from the border, Sittard was the first town, so to speak of, that was occupied by the German occupation forces. We had tried to escape. There were rumors that there might be an invasion, and several times we tried to leave, but then it was only a rumor, and people said, well, see, nothing really happened, it's just talk. And of course we went back to normal life again. And people really didn't take it too serious. They really never expected that Germany would invade countries like Holland. So when it did happen, it really came as a surprise. And then, of course, it was too late. After we were established in Holland, my father convinced the rest of our family they should do the same thing we did. It would be better for that period of time to be in Holland. And my mother was one of nine children, and most of the family he was able to convince, and they did come across the border, and they did start then life again in Holland. They had, one was a butcher, he had a butcher store, and one was, I remember, sister was married to a man, he was in the cattle business, and he started his cattle business again there, and life was great. And my mother's parents also came over and lived with in our area. So life was really beautiful again until the invasion. Then again, it started to change. You could see a change. The German propaganda started their work, which was very professional. And you had a Dutch Nazi party, and you did have Dutch Nazis all of a sudden that you didn't think would become Nazis, but they did. And looking back, I believe that this was more of an economic anti-Semitism. People that saw that they had an advantage financially by being or becoming Nazis. But they were there. And course, the first year wasn't that bad because they had to do a lot of fighting. They went to Belgium and France. But after they, this was all, so to speak, of taken care of, then, of course, they concentrated on the everyday's life. And they started what we called the Jew laws. Jew laws, I would say, started with we were not allowed to visit public places like movies, concerts, museums, and so forth. There was a curfew. We were not allowed to be on the street after 8 o'clock at night. And then, of course, we had to wear the Jew star to identify ourselves all the time that we were Jews. And the reaction of the Dutch population was beautiful. I remember when I first wore that Jew star, people that I never knew or never paid attention to all of a sudden gave me this friendly hello. And they used the word starkte. That means, you know, just be strong. It's not going to last, you know, that long anyway. It's just a period we have to try to get over. And I remember the whole country went on a nationwide strike to demonstrate that they do not approve of the way the Nazis treat their Jewish citizens. But then, of course, the Germans were capable of handling situations like that, and they arrested many good people and sent them to concentration camps, and many of them did not return.
These were Jews and non-Jews?
Mostly non-Jews. I remember the Germans took over a Jewish bank in Amsterdam called Lippmann Rosenthal. And all Jews in Holland had to send their, transfer their bank accounts, savings accounts, business accounts to this particular bank. All their holdings, all their stocks or bonds or whatever it was, certificates, everything had to be sent to Lippmann Rosenthal, which then, of course, was taken over by the Germans. Things became known that eventually Jews would be deported. But it was presented in such a way that, okay, here we are your masters, so to speak of, and we need labor in Germany because they were fighting on the East Front and on the West Front and in Africa. And you will be forced to work for us until this war, of course, over, which we will win. Then we'll, things probably will go back to normal. Whoever thought of a final solution as it was planned? And we used to get instructions from what they call the Yotzerat, the Jewish committee, and they send us a list. And they prepared us, so to speak of, in case you would be called for labor, Arbeitseinsatz, labor force in Germany, how to prepare yourself. And they gave us a list of what to wear, what to take along. And I remember we had special backpacks made and special warm underwear. And we even had a little first aid kit and vitamins. So we were prepared just in case we were called, so we go to work. And the question always was, so what? So we are still young, so we go to work. This is not going to last forever. He's not going to kill all the Jews. I mean, let's face it, this is, you know. In that order, we kind of prepared ourselves for the deportation. And I remember Jewish people gave their good things, like your silverware or your valuables, to the good non-Jewish friends, just to keep them until we come back. You know, it's not going to be that long anyway. And so did we. My, I remember at night we went to my father's foreman. He was the foreman of the factory, which for years they were good friends. And one night we packed the boxes and we brought the silver over to their house to safekeep for us. His other good friend, his name was Yesen. I remember he we had a few gold pieces which he kept for us, and I think I remember my dad had some money to which he didn't send to Lippmann Rosenthal, and I remember I bought a little house and I put it in his friend's name because it wasn't, so we had some money just in case, you know, when we come back that we have something again to get started with. And so we really didn't think serious anything about going there. A lot of people went into hiding. And we had an opportunity also, the four of us, by good friends who wanted to hide us. The problem was that nobody was able to take four people in one household. So we had to split up. And the way it was presented was that my dad and I were supposed to go with one family, my mother and my sister with another family. Now, these people were good people. Don't forget, food was rationed already. And we, of course, wouldn't get any coupons, so they had to share what they got with us. And this way, 8,000 people were saved that way in Holland during that period. However, my parents decided, since we were not allowed to know where the other two were, and that was done the underground, you know, it was a dangerous assignment, just in case one of us would get caught and they would force us to tell them where the others are. So therefore, we were not supposed to know where, let's say, my father and I weren't supposed to know where my mother and sister were. And that, of course, my parents decided against, and I felt they don't want to break up the family. And if we have to go, so we'll go like the rest of them. And, you know, after all, the same thing. We're still young, and we'll survive it, no problem. And sure enough, one day we were, they came to the house at like 1 o'clock midnight, and they marched us to the railroad station, and there was a special train, and we were deported. We were sent to a camp up north called Westerbork. Westerbork was a, I would say, a proper word would be a transient camp. All individual, all prisoners that were shipped to Germany or to Eastern Europe had to go through Westerbork. That's where they were registered and so forth. And from Westerbork, the trains left every Tuesday to the east. And the unique thing about Westerbork was they had a huge hospital. And here again, if you arrived in Westerbork and you were sick, you were not assigned on a transport. First, you were sent to the hospital to make sure that you are well, to present the image that you're not good to us if you cannot produce, so first let's cure you and then we'll send you to the gas chambers and to be gassed. Of course, we all didn't doubt it at that time, but it was Westerbork.
How long were you there?
I have difficulty with the time element. I remember we arrived there on November 11, 1942. That's when we were deported. And when we arrived, I remember the commander of the camp, his name was Obersturmbannführer Gemmiger. He was a German, like you see the cartoonists make him. And I was 17 years old at the time, and I was in good physical condition, and I was assigned as in the garbage collection group, which meant I got a little wheelbarrow and a barrel, and I had to go to the barracks and empty out the small barrels into the big barrel, and then I had to wheel them to the pile outside the camp where the garbage was. And it didn't bother me. I was able to handle that very easily. As a matter of fact, when I emptied out the garbage from the guardhouses, I always found some extra food in there, which was still good, and you know, the food was always a problem, but lots of time I found some stuff there that was still edible, and it didn't bother me. I was quite happy with this assignment. Then,
were you still with your family in this
yes,
camp?
Yes, our family were still together there, and we all were assigned different jobs in this camp. And then they asked for people who knew a trade, and of course I had become a cabinet maker after we weren't allowed to go to school anymore. I worked in our factory, and so I told them, and I worked in a carpenter shop then. From Westerbork, we were sent to Theresienstadt in Czechoslovakia. And that was...
What year was that?
That was, I don't know the exact time. I cannot give you the exact time.
This is tape two of an interview on January 16, 1996 with Mr. Kurt Moses in Boynton Beach, Florida.
From Westerbork, we were sent to Theresienstadt, the four of us, my parents, my sister, and I, together. We arrived in Theresienstadt, and we again were assigned different jobs. My sister, I remember, worked at the farm. They had farms outside the camp. And I think my mother was at some kind of an industry called glimmer, which they the women had to work. It had something to do with the defense industry. I really don't know exactly what it was. And I was assigned again to the carpenter shop, which wasn't too hard a work. The unique thing in Theresienstadt was we got paid. I got paid for my work with money. We had our own money. You probably have seen it. It's printed, and it says Theresienstadt and who the eldest was and so forth. The only problem with the money was you weren't able to buy anything with it. They did have a store with items showing in a window. And then I learned that this was all done because I believe Theresienstadt was helped by the Swiss Red Cross and to put on a show to make believe that this is the way it really was, which it wasn't. And whenever we got the inspection from the Swiss Cross, when the people came, and then everything was put to show and make believe that look how good we treat the Jews. And I remember the little children had to run up to the commander when he walked with his inspectors from Switzerland through camp and make believe that, you know, do you have any candy for us today and so forth. That was Theresienstadt. I didn't have any bad experience there. Of course, food was always a problem. You never had enough to eat. And the food, you were getting used to it already. It was always either potatoes and beets or carrots or stuff like that. But I was not exposed to any mistreatments or violence or anything like that. But we did have to work hard. We had to work in barracks, build barracks, and make furniture for the guard houses and so forth. Until one day, of course, they started deporting people from Theresienstadt to further east. We didn't know where, but to perform labor into the country. And sure enough, one day my dad and I were called, and we were supposed to be sent to other factories. I would say that's when my first bad experience started. We were pushed into a cattle car. I don't know how many at one time.
Do you know when this was?
When it was? Mm-hmm. It must have been in 44, beginning 44 already then. I don't know how many we were, but it was a very bad, terrible situation. I'll never forget that. And when those doors were closed and nobody had enough room to sit or stand, and people became violent, it's hard to describe. And of course, we didn't have any sanitary conditions there. We didn't have any food. And how long we were in that car. The time element is a problem when you get into a concentration camp. It's hard to explain. But we didn't have any watches. We didn't have any calendars. You don't know what day it is, what year it is, what time it is. You just exist. You live from one day to the next. And you hope that tomorrow the war is over and it's back to normal again. So how long we were in this situation, I really don't know. But I do remember the only thing I was hoping for to get out of that situation as fast as possible. It was really unbearable. People were fighting with each other. It was sad.
Were you near your father?
Yes. And sure enough, then the train, once it stopped, and then it went back, and then we moved again, and then we were standing still for God knows how long. And then finally, when the doors opened, we were in Auschwitz. I didn't know at that time that what Auschwitz was or that we were in Auschwitz. But when the doors opened, the SS stood there with their machine guns and with their dogs, and they were screaming, "Raus, raus!" We had to leave everything, little things that we still had behind. And I remember I had a coat and which I had from home. And I remember when we prepared for deportation, my mother had sewn in some extra money into the lining just in case that you need some extra money. So I wanted to take my coat with me, but I wasn't allowed to. I had to leave everything there, and we just had to get out of the train, line up in fives, and then we were marched through the gate. You probably have seen them on pictures. Arbeit macht frei, labor sets you free. And I was still under the impression, here, it's labor, we have to work. So, big deal, so we work. And, of course, once we got through the gate and we were in the camp, the first thing we encountered was the selection. And this SS officer stood there with his little cane, and he decided that who goes this side and who goes that side. And that's when that's when my father went to one side, I went to the other side. I think that was the last time I ever saw my dad, and I never saw him again. Then, of course, the selection consisted of twins. If there were any twins, they were separated. If you had any tattoos on your body, you were selected. We discovered after the war that these people were put to death, and the tattoo skins were used for lampshades for a overseer, a woman by the name of Ilse Koch. And when Ilse Koch was tried, those lampshades were used as evidence against her. After that, we had to undress naked, and they deloused us, which meant they had other prisoners, and they used some kinds of disinfectant on your body, and you were shaved, all your hair on your body and your head. And the Germans were always afraid of diseases. They were very particular. They always made sure that you don't carry any, like lice, who were carriers of diseases. And then, of course, we got our number tattooed on our prison number, and we got a striped jacket and a striped pants and a cap, and we got two shoes, and they weren't necessarily a left and a right one. And I remember distinctly those people who had two left shoes or two right shoes, they had to find somebody else who had the opposite, and luckily you had two shoes. And it turned out that later this was a very important thing in life in camp, because if you had shoes that didn't fit or caused any infection and you weren't able to walk straight, that was a reason. You know, if you didn't have any hospitals or medications, that sometimes could have led to problems. And you were, and you had other selections in camp that you were not felt to be qualified to go on.
Do you remember your number?
It's number B, the letter B, 11668. You don't forget those. After that, we were marched to a camp that's adjacent to Auschwitz. It's called Birkenau. And we were in Birkenau. And there, I met a prisoner who had been there before, who was sent there before. He had been there for some time. There was a communication problem because there were people from all countries. Most of them were from the Eastern countries. And of course, we had problems to communicate. And this man who was Dutch, he said to me, he said, do you people really know where you are here? We're here, you know, we're going to work. They probably assigned us to factories. And I really wasn't under the impression at that time that since my father was sent to the other side, who was at the time maybe in his early 50s, that he probably would get assignment of different kind of work than I, who was only, you know, in my teens, who probably would be sent to more physical work. And so I wasn't really so much concerned if eventually I'll probably see him again, you know. But this man said to me, he said, you know, this is really the end of the line. This is where people get gassed and cremated. And he said, you know the gate where you walk in? He said, and this is where you'll walk out. And he pointed to these chimneys, which I hadn't observed before, and they were smoking, which I didn't pay any attention to it. And then he explained to us the process, what happened to those people who went to the other side. And I just didn't want to believe it, you know. But unfortunately, then we learned the truth. One day in Birkenau, I mean, the food there, this camp was really, you can't describe what you saw there. This camp where we were in Birkenau, it's called the Zigeunerlager, the gypsy camp, which was named after the gypsies who were brought there, and they all were just gassed. There was no, they didn't even select them. They were just went, the whole camp was emptied out one night, and they all were gassed. So we were there and probably waiting, you know, we probably next. Food was, I mean, there the food was really, you know, we didn't get anything to eat, so to speak of. In the morning, we used to get a little piece of bread. And then in the afternoon, you had a little plate, and we used to get some soup. Supposed to be soup. The bread, you felt, well, you take a few bites and you save a little bit for later. And pretty soon you learn this doesn't work in Auschwitz. If one of the other prisoners now is that you carry a piece of bread on you, you're not going to have it too long in your possession. So the end result was, when you get this little piece of bread, you swallow it down as soon as you can. And then, so you go hungry the rest of the day. When you stand there with your little plate to get the soup and you have to line up, and you want to stand in front of the line, you take the chance that you get the top of the barrel, which is nothing but just the water. If you go to the end of the line, many times by the time they get to you, there isn't any left, and you end up with nothing. So you learn how to fight for your life, and you try to squeeze in the middle, and you hopefully you get some potato peels and some grass or whatever it's in there. And of course, it never was enough, it never was sufficient. And I would say, what was the worst experience in a concentration camp? It's very simple, it's hunger. You're constantly hungry. From the time you were there until you got out, there was nothing you wouldn't do to get your hand on a piece of bread. And even to this day, it's something that it's hard to explain. How could you explain to somebody what hunger is like? One day in Birkenau, this SS Oberscharführer, Otto Moll was his name. He was a big, heavy SS man. And he came and he announced that if any of the prisoners in my barrack had a trait, they should step forward. And at this point, there were five of us who always traveled. We were still together, boys, you know, like from Holland. We decided we try to stay together as long as we can and to help each other. And of course, I had a trade, and somebody else had a trade. He was a tool and die maker. And we decided the other three should come along. And at first they were not so sure. I said, look, what have you got to lose if you stay here? You know what chances you take. It's just a matter of time. So you have to get out of here. And we convinced them, and the five of us went on this. There was a truck standing, and we had to get on the truck. And before we went on the truck, this other mall said, he said, all of a sudden, Jews are all tradesmen. Before, they were all business people. Now, they all have a trade. He said, but if I discover that one of you lied, he said, you're not going to live too much longer. And then some of our friends got scared, but we held on to them, and we went, and we were transferred to a camp called Gleiwitz.
Could you spell that for us?
Gleiwitz. It used to be a Polish town called Gliwice. And when the Germans occupied Poland, they made it part of Germany, and they called it Gleiwitz. It's the same as Auschwitz, used to be Auschwitz. Gleiwitz, I would say, was maybe a half-hour ride on the truck. And what the Germans had done was this this area of Upper Silesia, Germany, was a very highly industrial area. They had a lot of factories there. And at that time, of course, most of them worked for war ammunition factories and so forth. The Buna, what was IG Farben, it's like a big chemical factory, the Krupp, who was the metal factory, they were all in that area. And what the Germans had done was they had set up little labor camps holding about 2,000 prisoners to subsidize the labor force in those factories. So there were civilian workers in those factories, let's say so many, and then they injected so many prisoners to subsidize, to help with the work that the other civilians were doing. And so we got to this camp called Gleiwitz 1. There were three camps in Gleiwitz. And Gleiwitz 1 was assigned, we had to work in a, what they call, Reichsbahn Ausbesserungswerk. The Reichsbahn means railroad. The railroad in Germany was federally owned. So this was a railroad repair shop for their system. All the railroad cars that were damaged from air attacks or other problems were sent to this factory, and we had to reinstall them again. We had to repair them again for work. And my assignment was with a group of, there were two Polish women in my assignment of the Schiebebühne, what they call it. Our responsibility was when a car had arrived at the factory, we were supposed to bring in that car and transfer to the appropriate area where that particular work had to be done. So which had really nothing to do, thank God, with carpentry work. And therefore, we were in good shape. We were able to do that kind of work. I was very fortunate because the other two women, the civilian women that worked with the two of us, were kind of very nice. We couldn't communicate because, you know, I didn't speak Polish and I didn't speak German or Dutch. But I remember every period of time we had to change shifts from day shift to night shift. And the factory supplied during the work shift the period where they could, you know, take a break, where they had their lunch. And the they had a kitchen there, and that prepared one particular food, like mixed potatoes with vegetables and sometimes a piece of ham or so in there. And that was free for the workers. Luckily, the women that with me didn't like that food. They always brought their own sandwiches along. But what they did when we worked night shift, and this was dangerous, they went to get the food, make believe they ate it, and then they hid it somewhere to make sure that we saw where they hid it, and then when the opportunity came, we were able to go there and gobble it down. Now this was only possible during night shift. During the weeks that we had day shift, it was too dangerous because there were too many more people there watching, and this was a problem. Looking back, I think if I wouldn't have had this extra food that we got when we had the night shift, possibly I would have been reduced to the stage of what we call the Musulman much earlier, and then we did have selections in Gliwice every period of time to make sure that we were still able to produce. And sometimes we had to jump to make sure that we were able to jump far enough. And if the SS person in charge thought that you didn't look right or you weren't physically able or capable, then there was a truck standing there, and you had to go up on the truck, and when the truck was full, then the truck went back to Auschwitz, and the truck came back with the same amount of people, let's say, that were new arrivals, and this was a constant exchange. That situation was always very sad, because you knew, and they knew, once you get on that truck, what the end was going to be, and you never would see them again. And some of the ones that had to get up on the truck, you knew for so long, and you went through them for such long periods, and you always felt bad. Those were very sad moments, I would say.
For the tape, could you say what you thought happened to those folks?
Well, we don't know, you know, not for sure, but the general idea was they went straight to the gas chamber. Because I don't know anybody that I knew who went on that truck. I don't know any of those that survived. I never saw any of them ever again. Work was very hard. We do had to work. This was hard physical work. And of course, food never was enough. After we went back to work, we could volunteer to do additional kitchen work. We were allowed to peel potatoes or peel vegetables for the guards for their food. Of course, you tried to volunteer because it gave you an opportunity that you were able to steal a few things and eat it while you were doing it. When you left the kitchen, you were checked to make sure that you didn't take any food with you. But at least you had an opportunity to swallow a couple of raw potatoes or carrots, whatever was there. Otto Mall was an individual who, he was a sadist, he was an alcoholic individual. Most of the time he was drunk. And that's when I really came eye to eye with executions and violent behavior, and you know, you see how people were killed and hanged. And a friend of mine got 30 lashes because he was caught praying one morning, and we had to carry him back. This was you can't describe it with words, but we saw there.
This is tape 3 of an interview with Mr. Kurt Moses on January 16, 1996, in Pompano Beach, Florida.
Otto Mall was an experience that I find very difficult to describe, that human beings exist who are capable of doing things what this man did. He got pleasure out of killing people, individuals. And he always, it was more of a challenge to him to pick the big ones and the tall ones. There wasn't a day that I remember that he wasn't drunk. We had to get out in the middle of the night and to stand on the Appell Platz, which was the center of the camp. We had to, in the winter time, I remember we had to stand naked there, we had to crawl in the snow, and the winters are severe there. Most of the time he did this, what he called gymnastics, after you came in from a day's work, from 10, 12 hours in the factory. The camp itself, we had about 2,000 in these little labor camps, and they were just barracks. Didn't get a chance to wash yourself, but we didn't have any underwear. There weren't any showers. If you look, there was a faucet, and if you had a chance to use the faucet to wash yourself off a little bit. Looking back, I never had any underwear when we went there. Food was terrible. Sleeping quarters, we had a barrack, and there were three-tier wooden shelves, like, and that's where you lied on. And when you woke up in the morning and you looked around, and there were always one or so that didn't make the night, and you wondered, maybe they're better off than you are. You woke up and realizing where you are, what you have to face again, and you reach the stage where you start thinking about probably you're better off not being there and face all this again. And the suicide rate was pretty high, and it was easy to do because the camp was surrounded with high voltage wire, and all you had to do is go and touch the wire. And of course, the first thing every morning you saw that they had a special commando of prisoners who had their card, and they used to go around the camp first and pick up all the bodies that were lying there of prisoners who went there during the night. To escape, I think, from my experience, was an impossibility in those camps. First of all, even if you would get out of the camp, where would you go to? I mean, here you are looking almost like a skeleton with a striped suit in a country where you can't speak the language. And don't forget, there were days where Germany was winning the war, and people were not too unfriendly against the German regime, because they benefited a lot by what they did to us. I remember when the short distance that we had to march from the camp to the factory, Germany was winning the war. These people stood there, and what they yelled at us, and the children were allowed to kick us and throw stones at us, you felt like, you know, you weren't human anymore. You were part of the, you were treated like an animal. And I think I learned that killing a human being really isn't the biggest crime. It's to degrade him, to dehumanize him. And I think that's what we were. People sometimes ask you question about your thinking. You weren't able, you weren't in a state to think like normal human beings. You were, that's it. I remember when we marched to and back and forth to the factory, the road we had to march on, people, I guess, didn't have a sewer system. They had a gutter, and the garbage was thrown in the gutter. And then when the rain came, it washed away the thing. Now, the trick was, when you had to march, we always had to line up in five to be on the outside so that you're close to the gutter. So when you could spot something that was edible, that you took a quick gripe and have something to eat. If you were caught doing this by the guards, you were punished. Your number was written down, and then once a week or so, they had payday, what they called. You had to line up, and the numbers were called, and then you got your punishment for what you did, depending on how many lashes. Usually, when you get over the 30 mark, you didn't get up anymore. That was the end of it. But that didn't mean anything to you because your reactions, you weren't thinking of what can happen to you if you get caught. All was on your mind was there was something to eat and you had to go for it. And that's how you live, day in and day out. The Germans were always, how shall I say, very culturally thinking. You had all these slogans and all these poems that they had written in the barracks and so forth. And our little camp, we had a band. We had a band that consisted of about 5 or 6 musicians. And every morning when we left for work, the band stood at the exit and played the same march every day. And the SS man in charge stood on the other side and he counted how many rows of 5 were leaving the camp. And the same thing happened when you came back. And that count had to be exact. If there was one missing, then you stood there for hours and hours. And I remember sometimes we had accident in the factories and one of our men got killed there by having the cart run over him. We had to carry this man back in camp and he had to be counted to make sure that the amount was correct. And I remember an incident when we marched out in the morning. And this is the way they ran it. They had a prisoner, I remember him well, he was a Czech, he was from Czechoslovakia. And they had his body displayed at the exit, naked with bullet wounds, and they had a sign next to it saying, "This man tried to escape, and this is the price he had to pay." And then when we came to this point, we all had to turn our heads to make sure that we were looking at this particular portrait. And other incidents, they just fabricated things. Of course, we weren't allowed to have any material things. And I remember one time the guard said they had caught a man who had still had a gold ring that he had kept, and he was wedding band or whatever it was, and he hadn't given that when he was supposed to, and this man in front of us, he just beat him to death. So I mean, sure, this man never had anything, but these were the situations, these were the lessons that they were showing us. This is what's happening to you if you don't obey by what we tell you to do. And the result, of course, was that you did what you had to do, and you were just hoping and there were times where you really didn't think you were going to make it. And I think the fortunate thing, the lucky thing was that we really, the 5 of us, kept together and we were able to help each other give each other, come on, you know, you kept up till now. It's not going to last that much longer. Someday something is going to happen, you know. After all, the world can't just stand by all the time. But Gleiwitz was a very, very sad, very bad period. And I think when the time came, we had to leave Gleiwitz, I don't think anybody really was sad about it. No matter what the outcome would be, no matter where we would go, you had seen the worst, you know, it only can get better. And sure enough, one morning when we came to the factory, And this was very unusual, never happened before. Instead of one ration of bread, we got two rations of bread. And something was wrong, something didn't click right. And there were rumors, they were demantling machinery already in the factory before, and they were shipping it back into Germany. But of course, you have no contact with the outside world. You don't know what's happening, war, invasion. We didn't know any of those things. And occasionally we had seen a Russian plane flying, but that wasn't anything to, really to make a rumor of it or so. But the thing started when they gradually exchanged the SS guards. More of the younger people, more of the younger guards were replaced with older guards, men in their 60s or 50s, whatever it was. And the bad thing, of course, was that, looking back, you think, okay, you take a young German who grew up in the Hitler Jugend, who was trained and educated and taught all the Nazi theories, he probably might not have known better. But to take a man who is in their 60s and who has a family and to do the same thing that this young person did, he did. And they try to keep up and make sure that they did just as good a job with than the younger ones did, and they did. And I sometimes wonder, looking back, I wish I would have met somebody who would have shown a little compassion, understanding. I would have given an extra piece of bread or something like that. So at least at this time I could say, well, they weren't all bad. Didn't occur, didn't happen. Yeah, I wish sometime it would. So then we realigned up after we had the second piece of bread, and we were told that the factory is going to be closed and they're going to move us into Germany. We had to go to the railroad station and we would be transferred to a German factory into Germany. We went, train never arrived. They said the railroad trucks were damaged, were bombed, and the train never came. I don't know how long we were there waiting. So then they decided we can't go back, we should march into Germany as far as we get. And then they had combined the other two Gleiwitz camps with us, so there were about 6,000 of us. And then we started to march, and this was in January 45. Winters in that part of the country are very severe. This was a lot of snow, a lot of ice, a lot of cold. And we just marched. And you came to the point where you couldn't march anymore. And those who weren't able to continue, they were just shot alongside the road and just left there. I think the third day we marched, and during the night we were put up in that used to be a French prisoner of war camp, which had been vacated, was empty, and they put us into those barracks just for the night. And the next morning we were supposed to go on. And that was the time where we really, the five of us, we sat there and said, well, We just can't. You couldn't physically, you couldn't do it. And we saw what happened to the ones that on the way, so we decided we're not going to go. We're going to stay here. We try to hide, and whatever may happen, happens. That's the end of it. And the next morning early, they called, and everybody had to get out, and they started counting again. But the guards were very nervous, and everything had to go schnell, schnell, very quick, quick. And they realized that not all prisoners were out there. And we hid under the bunks in the barracks. So we are found, and so forth. But apparently they didn't want to take the time to look for them. They just put up a few machine guns, and they just mowed through the barracks. And luckily we weren't hit. And we were lying there, I don't know for how long, and then we found out the noise was gone, and we looked, and they had marched, and we were in the barracks. And I think we were there until the next day, and all of a sudden this Russian tank. Yeah.
Do you know what day that was?
I think it was January 17th, something like that. But I remember this tank, and this thing opened up, and this guy stuck his head out, and he just looked at us. And then he closed it again and left. And here we were, but at least then we knew that the Germans weren't there anymore, that the Russians were there. There was a, you know, we were in between the fire for overnight. You could hear the shooting and all this back and forth. We were in between. But then the Germans apparently retreated, and the Russians were there. And this is like in a forest, like, you know, you didn't see any houses or any other people. So here we are now, lying in this barrack, and of course the first thing on your mind is food. How can we get food? And we went into this kitchen of this Bleshammer, of this prisoner of war camp, but there wasn't much left. There was whatever there was. We ate, and unfortunately, I remember there was one bottle. And it looked like grape juice. And one of our fives took the bottle and drank it, and he died. Then, what's the next step? Where are you going to go? What are you going to do? You're in a strange country. You can't communicate with anybody. This was the worst. You picked up a few words. And here you're in a stripe, you know, in a nothing. What are we going to do? So, of course, first we started, when we walked out of the area, we went, there were a lot of farms there, and we started begging for food. We asked them. I had the feeling that when they saw us, a lot of them were afraid not to say no, you know, sure, you know. You could see by the reaction of the people, you know, that, you know, we didn't do this to you, you know, sure, what do you want? They were very helpful and very... But they wanted to get rid of us as soon as possible. Whatever we wanted, they gave us, but please leave, you know, which was fine. And, so the first thing, of course, we did was to make sure that we had enough to eat, and that we went back to Gliwice, which was a city. Of course, it's a pretty big city. And they had set up like Red Cross agencies and so forth, and we went there. And they gave us, got rid of our striped clothes, we got underwear, we got clothes. They gave us food to eat and so forth. And don't forget, the war wasn't over until May 45. This is January. So we weren't able to go home yet. So we had to stay around, which we didn't know when the war was over. And the first thing we did when we felt a little bit more strength, we went back to Auschwitz. And although we knew what had happened at the selection, but you still, you know, you never give up hope. Yep.
When you got to Auschwitz, what did you do?
We wanted to see who we know, who, whether my father, maybe some miracle happened that he was still alive. So we stayed in Auschwitz. We went to City Hall, and I figured we didn't have any ideas, we didn't have any papers, nobody knew who we were, what my name is, and so, I mean, here years have passed. I couldn't even, I tried a pencil, I couldn't even write anymore. It was just, you know, things that you take for granted, you just, it isn't there. So we went to City Hall and we told them that we are from Holland and we want to go back to give us some idea. The problem was that the Russians used to arrest the Germans on the streets and send them to Russia, to Siberia, to work. And, well, we didn't look quite as well as they did, but we were afraid, since we couldn't communicate with them, that they took us maybe for different as what we were. So the City Hall in Auschwitz gave us a certificate in different languages that we were, had been prisoners there, and that we are on our back on our way back home, and they should cooperate helping us. I still have that. And then of course we went to Krakow. We stayed behind the Russian lines. We felt as long as they keep on moving forward, then we are right behind them. And we were in Krakow, which is a big city. We stayed in Krakow for a while. And then when they ran into Czechoslovakia, I wanted to go back to Theresienstadt, because my mother and sister were at last been in Theresienstadt. So finally we reached that period and we got to Theresienstadt. However, Theresienstadt, when we got to the camp, they had a typhus epidemic. The camp was closed, they wouldn't allow anybody in. And I talked to somebody on the gate, I said, would you be able to find out if they were there? And he came back and he said, yes, they're both alive, they're both there. So then we waited till night time and we climbed over the fence. Sure enough, I met my sister, and then they had like a little hospital thing, and she told me my mother had typhus and she was in the hospital there at the time. This is quite difficult. You have to understand that My family was very close family. My parents were. We grew up, never heard an argument or a fight or a disagreement. Difficult for me. It's hard to describe, but I knew my mother would never survive if she knew that my father wasn't there. And when she saw me, of course, the first thing was, where's Dad? And I told her, I said, he went home already. I said, he's waiting for you.
This is tape four of an interview on January 16th, 1996 with Mr. Kurt Moses.
I believe if I would have told her the truth then, she probably wouldn't have survived. And luckily, she did survive. I went back first. I was very fortunate. I went to Pils in Czechoslovakia, and we got, that was American zone. And we got a flight back to France, and from France I went back to Holland. My mother's sister and a brother, who were hidden during the war, had come out of hiding and had started their business again, at a butcher shop. So we found each other, and I moved in with them. And then my sister came, and my mother, and we moved in with them. And of course, when we had to tell my mother the truth when she came, and it never was the same again. She just couldn't cope with it. It was very, very sad situation. There was nothing that meant anything to her, and we tried to convince her that my sister and I, that we need her, that she has to go on, and she stayed with us, and she did, and she came with us to America, too. And she just didn't want to go on. And she died after 1 year in America. said. I guess once she saw that we were set, we were able to make it ourselves, that she was no longer needed. And I think she was 52 years old. So then life went on, and can't live in the past all your life.
When did you come to the United States?
January 1947. And then I realized you can't live in the past. You have to go on. You have to start a new life for yourself. And you have to use the old medicine when used in Holland when they said stark, you got to be strong. And you pull yourselves together and you try to be strong and you go on and you make a new life for yourself. And I was very fortunate because with my trade, I had no problem finding a job. I was the first place I went to, I was hired, especially you were a European, a German cabinet maker, you were well in demand. And I remember I started off with $1 an hour. I was the richest man in the world. I made been overtime, $50, $60 a week. I didn't know what to do with all the money. And my mother's oldest brother, who gave us our affidavit to come here, he gave me good advice and he helped me, and I was very fortunate. And life had been good to me here, and what can you say about America? It's great. And I enjoyed it, and I was determined not to live in the past. I made lots of friends here, and I lived in Brooklyn. I lived two blocks from Ebbets Field. I became a baseball fan, and
did you have a family?
I really enjoyed my early years here, and then I dated, and then I met my wife. We are married 41 years now, and I think that really contributed a lot to bring back and restore trust and love again into your life. I think, looking back, it wasn't the easiest period. I think I had difficulties because it's hard to... How can you explain it? To find trust in somebody. You're skeptical. Everything is questioned. You know, you had such an experience. Is this really true? Or is it like the rest of it was? I had problems with that. But then, of course, you realize you can't... continue that way. There has to be a way. And I think I overcame this. And once I went to school at night, and once you know the language and you become a little bit Americanized, I think things come back to normal again. Although I was brought up Orthodox, I couldn't get back to religion. That's the thing. I just couldn't bring myself to believe again that you know, the formula that God could have seen this and had let it happen. It just didn't penetrate. It just couldn't. I tried, but it didn't work. And it took me a long, long time, I would say, until I had my family again. Then you felt, well, of all those millions, why me? There had to be something there. And I think it had to be something I had to be thankful for. And I think because it was deep enough, that's what was easier to come back again, I think. I realized that there had to be something that gave back to me what I have now. And we have, how shall I say, we lead a religious life. And you went back again into normal ways of thinking. I would say the first few years, especially at the age of I was looking back, had a tremendous hate for Germans, for Nazis, what they did to us. And it was like an obsession. I mean, this was also after we were first liberated and we were still in Germany. We you know, you were so, look what you did to us, kind of syndrome. And then you learn you can't go on hating all your life either. Who was it, Santana, who said that hate is a confession of inferiority? Might be true, but then Santana never was in a German concentration camp. And Anne Frank, she still believed in the good of humanity. She wrote that before she went to Bergen-Belsen. Had she come back, maybe she would have worded a little bit differently. But again, like I said, you can't spend the rest of your life hating. And I think we went back to Europe a few years ago. I took my family. They wanted to know the roots. And I went back to Germany, too. I went back to Linnick, I went to my grandparents' cemeteries, and surprisingly, the younger people, I was able to establish a relationship to communicate easier. The older ones tried to avoid me, and I tried to avoid them. And of course, my question always was, what do your parents tell you when you ask them why they did this to us? What's their answer? And all of them said, whenever we ask a question related to that error, they'll say, that's in the past, we don't want to talk about it. And we don't get an answer from them. So I took them to Germany, I took them to our house, it's still there. went back to Holland, and I still have very good friends in Holland, classmates. As a matter of fact, they made me a party when I came back. We had a good time, they're good people. And I would say, all in all, life has been good to us. We have a lot to be thankful for. I think the fact that, like I said, we have a family. My wife, my daughters, Wendy, Michelle. We have a grandson, Zachary Moses. We have a lot to be thankful for. And to live in this country that gave us the opportunity to give us a chance to start a new life. You have to cry. I think I think what Shoah does, the foundation, to give us this opportunity to talk, and that there are people there who want to listen. And I think we owe them a great deal of thanks. And people like my interviewer, Ms. Pat Pavda, many thanks. My cameraman, America. And I think it's important that we get the opportunity to do this. I think it's important for the future generations to know what can happen when hatred rules, and how important it is that you use the opportunity that you have when you see injustice, that you get involved, that you don't wait and you don't stand by and don't wait until the other person does something. You're the one that has to get involved. We have a great system. We have a great country. You have to be thankful for that, and you have to be realistic. You have to participate, and you have to make sure that things like this never shall happen again. And I would say I thank you all for giving me the opportunity to talk about this and to tell you about it. And I think it's important that we shall never forget this. And I thank you all for your help to keep my promise that I will never forget them.
Thank you very much.
That's a picture of my sister, Lori, who was 4 years old at that time. And our nanny and me, who was 1 year old at that time. And the picture was taken in Linnick. That's a picture of my mother and my sister Lori again and me. I think I was about 3 or 4 years old at the time. And that picture was also taken in Lenox. And that's a picture of our family. And that was taken in Holland, when we lived in Holland in Geleen. And that's my father, my mother, my sister Lori, and myself. I would say I was about 12 or 13 years old at the time. That is my Jod star. That's the star that we had to wear during the German occupation in Holland. And I like to add, very proudly, I wore it. That picture was taken in Holland in Sittard, and I was 16 at the time. I remember it quite well. This is the certificate that I received at the City Hall in Auschwitz after we were liberated. It's in several languages, and it tells you that we were prisoners in Auschwitz, and we are on our way back to Holland, and please give us your help when we need it. This is my family when we were vacationing in, I think it was in Beach Haven on the shore, I think little Michelle, and Wendy, and my wife Doris, and myself. I think this was about, Michelle maybe was about 5 or 6, and Wendy 8, and I was much, much younger then. This is my present family as of 1996. That's my two daughters, Wendy Michelle, my wife Doris, and my two son-in-laws, John and Larry. This is our latest edition, our pride and joy, little Zachary Moses Martik, 3 months old.